Well, good morning and a very warm welcome to St. John's and our service here today. Particular welcome if you're new and joining us online for the first time. We're thrilled to have you with us. My name's Andy. I'm the vicar here at St. John's. And a little bit later, we'll be hearing from David, one of our licensed lay ministers, who will be preaching to us from the book of 1 Thessalonians, which is the book that we're working through this Advent. And so I thought we could begin our service with some words of acclamation from that book, which remind us of the life we've been called to live in the Lord Jesus Christ. So if I say the words in normal type, if you would like to reply with the words in bold. This is the will of God for us in Christ Jesus. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances. We're going to join together now in our first song, which is Light of the World, Here I Am to Worship.
Down into darkness, opened my eyes.
Today is the first Sunday of Advent, and Advent is a time where not only do we look forward to celebrating Christ's first coming at Christmas, but we also look ahead to his second coming when he will come in glory. And we're told that when Christ comes, he will bring to light all those things that are now hidden in darkness, and he will disclose the purposes of the heart. And in that knowledge, that encourages us now, in the light of Christ, to confess our sins and to confess the fact that the purposes of our heart are not always wholesome and holy. But to confess them in the sure and certain knowledge that in the Lord Jesus Christ we can know forgiveness and restoration. So let us now join together in the words on screen. Lord, we have not kept watch for you. We have occupied ourselves with our own concerns. We have not waited to find your will for us. We have not noticed the needs of the people around us. We have not acknowledged the love that has been shown to us. Forgive us for our lack of watchfulness. Help us to wait to know your will. Help us to look out for the needs of others. Help us to work and watch for your coming. Amen. May the God of all healing and forgiveness draw us to himself and cleanse us from all our sins, that we may behold the glory of his Son, the Word made flesh, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We come now to our notices, and just a few things to let you know about. Most of them you will already have heard about in my congregation letter, which went out just earlier this weekend. First thing, I've already mentioned that it is the first Sunday of Advent, which means it is the first day of our Advent devotional. A child shall lead them. Every household should have received one of these through the post, and I just commend this to us as a great way for us to engage with God's word during Advent and to prepare our hearts for celebrating Christmas. If you didn't get one, or you would prefer to engage with this electronically, then you can find it on the diocese website, and again there is a link in the letter that I sent. Also, another thing that was in my letter is our call to pray and give. Those 2 weeks of committed prayer are now coming to an end. And anyone who would like to respond in this time of crisis and contributing towards the financial difficulty of some parishes in the diocese, then you should have received an envelope and a response card. Like I said, if you would like to respond, then please do bring those next time we are meeting at church, which is next week, December the 6th, which I'll say a word about in a minute. And if you're not able to come to church at the moment, then do get in touch with me or Tracy, and we can always arrange collection or delivery of those if you would like to contribute. But as I said, next week, I'm really happy to be able to say that we will be able to be back in church together. As you, I'm sure, are aware, on Wednesday, the national lockdown will end, and as a county, Lancashire will enter into Tier 3. But the good news is that despite being at the highest level of restrictions, we are still able to meet and gather for public worship. So we will return to meeting in person in church at 10:30 and 4 o'clock on Sundays. We will also be uploading that 10:30 service to YouTube for those who aren't yet able to come and join us in person at church. As I've said in my letter, of course, we still need to ensure that our services are COVID secure. So just a reminder that anyone coming to church, please do sanitize hands on entrance and exit of church. Please do maintain that social distancing. And please do come with a face covering, covering your nose and mouth, unless you are exempt. So that's a return to church. And then the only final thing to say that was also in my letter is that we're starting to publicise our plans for Christmas services and celebrations. As I've said, it'll be a little bit tentative. There may need to be changes and flexibility depending on what happens with the coronavirus situation. But more information will be coming, and particularly how to book and the booking system. That isn't opened yet, but because of limited numbers, there will need to be some booking for some of the services. So we will let you know how to do that in the weeks ahead. So I think that is all the notices that I need to draw to your attention. We're now going to have our Bible reading, which is brought to us by Judith Watson.
Our reading today is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and we are starting to read at verse 17. But brothers, when we were torn away from you for a short time, in person, not in thought, out of our intense longing, we made every effort to see you. For we wanted to come to you, certainly I, Paul, did, again and again, but Satan stopped us. For what is our hope, our joy, or the crown in which we will glory in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ when he comes? Is it not you? Indeed, you are our glory and joy. So when we could stand it no longer, we thought it best to be left by ourselves in Athens. We sent Timothy, who is our brother and God's fellow worker in spreading the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you in your faith, so that no one would be unsettled by these trials. You know quite well that we were destined for them. In fact, when we were with you, we kept telling you that we would be persecuted, and it turned out that way, as you well know. For this reason, when I could stand it no longer, I sent to find out about your faith. I was afraid that in some way the tempter might have tempted you, and our efforts might have been useless. But Timothy has just now come to us from you, and has brought good news about your faith and love. He has told us that you always have pleasant memories of us, and that you long to see us just as we also long to see you. Therefore, brothers, in all our distress and persecution, we were encouraged about you because of your faith. For now we really live, since you are standing firm in the Lord. How can we thank God enough for you in return for all the joy we have in the presence of our God because of you? Night and day we pray most earnestly that we may see you again and supply what is lacking in your faith. Now may our God and Father himself and our Lord Jesus clear the way for us to come to you. May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else, just as ours does for you. May he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So let us pray. Lord, we thank you that we can come to your word. We can openly read and digest what you have to say to us. So just ask that you be with me as I look at this passage from 1 Thessalonians, and that we can somehow apply it to our situation and our lives today. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're in the middle of chapter 2 of 1 Thessalonians, and the passage really shows unusually, or perhaps emphatically, Paul's feelings, Paul's humanity for what he's doing. because he's talking about his emotions. A lot of it is his emotions because he can't actually see and be with the people in Thessalonica. Now, the passage starts with the word but. Now, that suggests that we need to look back at what has gone immediately beforehand. And Paul is writing to them from some distance away. And in last week's, in the first part of chapter 2, Paul has tells the Thessalonians why he came, or what he did when he came. He's just reminding them because of what he says later on in this the letter. Now, if you want to read about what happened, why Paul is in this situation, then Acts 17 records very briefly this part of Paul's missionary journey. And basically, he was preaching in Thessalonica, but the Jewish opposition built up, they hired a mob, and there were riots. And eventually, Paul had to leave by night very quickly for his own safety. And the situation hasn't improved. There are still people opposed to Paul, and he can't go back. So that's why he's there, and why he feels, first of all, in the first part of chapter 2, he reminds the Thessalonians, and he tells us that he came to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ, crucified and risen. And that's his core message. And what he sees himself as is he uses four different pictures. One of a herald proclaiming the gospel, one as a steward, a keeper of the gospel, and in various aspects towards the Thessalonians as father and mother. Maybe a mix-up, and it's very difficult to see, but if you go back to what we did last week, you can see where Paul's coming from. So these are the pictures that he wanted to build up in the Thessalonians' minds as he proclaims the gospel. But now he can't go and carry on that work. His work started, it had got some good results. It says in Acts that some of the Jews from the synagogue believed. There were some Greek men and also some Greek women who also believed. So there was he left, albeit cutting his visit short, he did leave a young fellowship, a young church in Thessalonica. And he does say that Satan got in his way. Satan has prevented him from going back to the church to carry on his work there. Not certain as to what Satan was doing that prevented Paul. There's various suggestions. No total 100% conclusion. It may be that the temperature was still very hot, and the Jews that were opposing him were still ready to arrest him and put him in prison. But whatever reason, and Paul was given perception as to where he should go and where he shouldn't go, Satan was blocking his return. As far as the actual reasons, I think we've just got to say we don't know. But we've got to believe that Paul knew what he was talking about, and also that the Thessalonians knew what Paul was talking about. Obviously, they had a good understanding as to why he couldn't go back to them. But through frustration, he sends Timothy. He can't bear it any longer. He hasn't heard anything from the church there. So he sends Timothy on an expedition to find out what's going on. He sends him from Athens, and it's a very serious matter for Paul to send Timothy away, because it means Paul will be separated and will be on his own during this time. Now, just as an aside, we can see even from Paul, this strong leader and one of the apostles, he still needed people to work with him. He still needed co-workers, he still needed a team. And it's perhaps it's a message to any Christian who thinks they can go it alone. We need people. We need other people to talk about, to bounce our ideas off, to pray with, and to work with. So for Paul, it was a very serious matter that he would be alone in Athens. Particularly if you're again reading in Acts, it was a very a city full of idols, full of idolatrous worship, and Paul was felt quite bereft by this situation. But overriding this, he wanted to know what was going on with the Thessalonians. So he sent Timothy off. Again, if you follow Acts, you'll see that Paul, after Thessalonica, he moved into other places, ended up in Athens, and eventually moved on to Corinth. And it's believed that in Corinth he wrote 1 Thessalonians when Timothy had returned. So he sends Timothy out on a mission, and he gives him three points, three things for this purpose. First of all, it was to strengthen and encourage the believers. New church, he'd set their roots in proclaiming the gospel, but then he had to leave the job unfinished. As we see in Paul moving around on his missionary journeys, he did like to spend quite some time in the towns and the cities that he actually established churches. He needed not just to proclaim the gospel, but to nurture the people. And this is what he couldn't do, and why he's particularly worried about the situation with the Thessalonians. Again, as an aside, it's quite a stark message to us that if we are involved in any way of in any sort of outreach or preaching of the gospel or teaching or contact with outsiders, other people, it's not sufficient just to bring them to the point of conversion. That's the first point. But the new believers, new churches, new groups need nurture. They need building up. And so this is Paul's two-prong attack. First of all, he preaches the gospel, and we see that in Acts, in the number of churches he goes to, in the sermons he delivers. But he also stays and works with the new converts in building them up. Quite a long way throughout this this passage, I constantly was reminded about the parable of the sower, Jesus' parable of the sower, where the sower goes out and spreads good seeds on the ground, or the different types of ground it landed on. And one, of course, one was where it's the seed fell and it started to grow, and it started to flourish. The plants came through. But then the opposition came, and the plants hadn't had time to establish their roots, and so they withered and died. Now, this is what Paul is bothered about. He hasn't been able to nurture the congregation. So for us, again, anyone that comes to that point of conversion, they have to be nurtured. They have to grow, and we have to help them. We can't just give them a Bible and say, carry on. They do need nurture. Obviously, we do have the Bible, we have the New Testament, which tells us about Jesus Christ, that people in Paul's day didn't have. All they had was his preaching. But we still need nurture. We still need to grow. And similarly, we as established Christians need to grow. We need to be taught, we need teaching, we need to read, we need to listen to God. And we need to grow. So it's an ongoing, lifelong learning process. It doesn't stop when we first respond to Jesus Christ crucified and risen. So he sends Timothy off. He wants to make sure that they are not being deceived by these false teachers, to be unsettled. He wants Timothy to settle them down in the ways that they believed from the first words of Paul are still true. And in general, it's see how they're getting on. And that should be our mission, as well as proclaiming the gospel, to see how people are getting on in their faith. Not just the ones that come to the first lessons and the first courses on discipleship, but on people that are been around a lot longer. See how they're getting on. And that was Timothy's charge. And he comes back and he is full of good news for Paul. And he's overwhelmed that they are still growing in faith. They are still there. They have fond memories of Paul. They like, they want to see him again. And presumably they have some understanding as to why Paul can't be there. But he still feels that this is the reason why he's writing the letter now, to explain to them the exact situation that he's in. They're still troublemakers. But Paul is overwhelmed by joy. But what he does say is that he does want to come to see them again, and he does want to supply what is lacking in their faith. Again, it's a reminder that we don't get everything right the first time round. We do need teaching, we do need to understand a lot further study. Once we've got to that point of making a commitment to Jesus Christ. So there are obviously gaps in what Timothy tells Paul. He doesn't deal with them here, he does start to deal with them later on in the letter. But for the time being, he is overwhelmed by joy, acknowledging that it's not 100% perfect faith, and it never will be. So he does need to go back and see them. He does want to go back and see them. And in his final prayer, again, he prays at the end of chapter 3, he prays that God will bring Paul back to Thessalonica, which he does, but it takes 5 years or thereabouts. He does go back eventually to see them. But for the time being, they've seen Timothy, they've had some encouragement from Timothy, and they're also receiving Paul's letters of instruction about what is lacking, and that comes, as I say, comes later in the letter. And the second thing in his final prayer is increasing love. Paul's mission is not just one of faith, it's one of love. Love for each other, love for the brethren, love for the fellow members of the congregation or the church, and for everybody else. It's not confined to the little bubble that you happen to live in. It's confined to the world. And this is also Paul's prayer. It's also part of his mission. We see it time and time again. And certainly his love for the people in Thessalonica is expressed in this letter, more so than perhaps anywhere else. And finally, he has one final prayer, which is perhaps appropriate for Advent Sunday. Verse 13 of chapter 3, the last verse in his prayer, he says, I want you to be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus Christ comes with all his holy ones. When our Lord Jesus comes. The whole of Paul's preaching, the whole of the gospel, has got to end with one final point. He's not building up a church of nice people to have a nice, comfortable life here and now, and perhaps to go off to heaven when they die. That is part of what he's talking about, love between each other, spreading the gospel. But there is more to it. Anyone who starts up a new organisation or a new club and it spreads throughout the world, any sort of organisation, is fine that it brings together like-minded people for a particular purpose. And it may be model railway building or stamp collecting or fell walking or anything else. And that's fine. That's a good place to meet people of your own type that you like and get on with. But this is not the gospel. This is not what Paul is about. He is about building up a church which will be looking forward to Jesus' return. Now, obviously the people living and reading Paul's letter to start with have died since this and have not, and Jesus hasn't returned. But that is the Christian gospel, that Jesus will return. That's as Andy said at the beginning of the service. It is Advent is looking forward to Jesus' return. And so the final prayer is that they will be ready, they will be blameless and holy when Jesus returns. All the other things need dealing with now, but they need to be preparing for the second coming of Jesus. And that's where Paul finishes his prayer, that's where Paul finishes his explanation as to why he's writing this letter. And he says throughout this that he can see that his gospel and the people are two important. He comes with the gospel and preaches it to the people who form a church or a congregation or whatever word you want to use. But that doesn't stop there. They're then charged with sending that gospel out to others, to form other churches, who in turn will receive the gospel, and in turn will start sending the word of God out again to other churches, to establish other churches. And that goes on and on until Jesus comes. Amen.
David, thank you so much for that encouragement and challenge and that feeding from God's word. And we're going to respond to that now by declaring our faith in the truths and the realities that are revealed in those scriptures. So as the words come up on screen, let's declare our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our prayers of intercession are led for us by David and Sandra Gaskell.
When in glory, Lord, you come, not the trumpets, not the drum, not the anthem, not the psalm, not the thunder, nor the calm, not the shout the heavens raise, not the chorus, not the praise, not the silences sublime, nor the sounds of space and time. But your voice, when you appear, shall be music to my ear. But your voice, when you appear, shall be music to my ear. when, O Lord, you're seen again. Not the glories of your reign, not the lightnings through the storm, not the radiance of your form, not the grace and power alone, nor the splendours of your throne, not the robe and diadems, not the gold and not the gems, but your face upon my sight shall be darkness into light. But your face upon my sight shall be darkness into light. When, Lord God, to human eyes, you bestride our narrow skies, not the child of humble birth, not the carpenter of earth, not the man by all denied, not the victim crucified, but the God who died to save, glorious victor o'er the grave. Lord, the one to whom I fall, Jesus Christ, my all in all. You're the one to whom I fall, Jesus Christ, my all in all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In these strange and fearful times, bless those on the front line of care for the desperately ill patients. Give wisdom and humility to the leaders of nations, that all may rejoice in your salvation. We thank you for the care of scientific researchers who strive to provide vaccines to protect from disease. Give to all peoples the fruit of their labours. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Precious in your eyes, Lord, is the death of your saints. We give thanks for the hospices of our communities and nation. Draw near to all who approach death. Give them the assurance that the best is yet to be, and that death has no sting for those safe and secure in Christ. And give to each one the assurance that loved ones will be in your tender care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
In the midst of so much suffering in our broken and divided world, we pray the ancient prayer, Maranatha, Lord, come quickly, but make us watchful and keep us prayerful, that when you shall appear in power and great glory, and every eye shall see you, you may not find us complacent in sin, but active in your service, joyful in your praise, and faithful in witness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
As our Saviour has taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power,
and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We're going to conclude our time of prayer with a prayer that very much picks up on what David was encouraging us about from 1 Thessalonians, that call to move on in our faith, to mature in our faith, that call to be towards blamelessness and holiness when the Lord Jesus Christ comes. And this prayer is a prayer asking that God would do that work in us. So let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and to put on the armour of light. Now in the time of this mortal life, in which your Son Jesus Christ came to us in great humility, so that on the last day, when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge the living and the dead, we may rise to life immortal through him who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our final song picks up on many of the themes that we have thought about, and particularly apt for these themes of Advent and light and darkness. We sing, "Longing for light, we wait in darkness." So do join us after the service on Zoom at 11:30 for virtual coffee if you're able to. If you're not able to join us via Zoom, Why not put into practice something that we've heard there of that encouraging one another, checking up on one another, seeing how one another are doing in our faith, and give someone a phone call over a brew and a biscuit. But now let me close with a final prayer of blessing. Christ, the Son of Righteousness, shine upon you, scatter the darkness from before your path, and make you ready to meet him when he comes in glory. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. May the Lord, when he comes, find us watching and waiting. Amen. As we await our coming Saviour, go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.